viewers, welcome to Newsweek South Asia, a show where we'll provide you fresh insights into South Asia's geopolitical, strategic and security situation. Let's begin the show with the headlines first. Twin terror attacks in Jammu and Kashmir, former village headman killed and tourist couple injured. Karachi faces mounting anger over prolonged electricity and gas load shedding. And Indian ATS arrests four Sri Lankan nationals linked to ISIS. A former sarpanch was killed while a tourist couple from India's Jaipur city was injured in two separate terror attacks in Jammu and Kashmir's Shopia and Anantnag districts respectively. In the wake of this recent twin terror attacks in Jammu and Kashmir, Pakistan's relentless obsession with Kashmir stands exposed. Despite the passage of an entire generation since the partition, Islamabad continues its futile attempts to disrupt peace and progress in the region. We have a report.
A whole generation has passed since the partition between India and Pakistan, but Islamabad refuses to end the Kashmir obsession. Rattled by a peaceful and progressive environment in Jammu and Kashmir, the neighboring country is trying every trick in the book to unleash violence and chaos in the region. On May 18th, the region was shaken by twin terror attacks. In Anantnag's Yanar area, a couple from Rajasthan's Jaipur, Farha and her spouse Tabriz, were injured as terrorists opened fire upon them. Swiftly, the police immediately shifted them to a nearby hospital for treatment.
जैसे काम बस में से वो ट्रेवल टेम्पो से उतर रहे थे होटल में जाने खाना खाने के लिए जैसे अंदर जाने लगे और लोग तो अंदर चले गए वो कुछ दूरी पर रह गए इस तरह वो मोटरसाइकिल पाए और गोली फायरिंग करके भाग गए
इन अ सेपरेट फायरिंग इंसिडेंट विद इन एन आवर ऑफ द अनंतनाग अटैक टेररिस्ट्स ओपन फायर ऑन अ सिविलियन इन हीरापोरा शोपियां डिस्ट्रिक्ट टेररिस्ट्स फायर्ड अपॉन एजाज अहमद शेख अ फॉर्मर विलेज हेडमैन and local politician who succumbed to his injuries at the hospital.
Ezaz Ahmed Sheikh, jo former sarpanch the, elected sarpanch the, Shopiya ke, aur bada popular the, logon mein kaafi kaam usne kiya, aur maine un social media mein bhi uske kaafi dekha hai, bahut active aadmi the, to उनको बेसिकली टारगेट मैं समझता हूँ इसलिए किया जा रहा कि एक तो लोगों के काम कर रहे थे तो टेररिस्ट नहीं चाहते कि कोई भी चाहे वो कश्मीरी मुस्लिम हो या कश्मीरी हिंदू हो या सिख हो वो लोगों के मसलों को हल करे और उनको रिजॉल्व करने की कोशिश करे उनमें पॉपुलर हो जाए तो मैं समझता हूँ ग्रास रूट डेमोक्रेसी को वो नहीं चाहते कि वो रूट्स पकड़े जम्मू कश्मीर में क्योंकि ये टेररिस्ट जो है ये पाकिस्तान की डीप स्टेट के इंस्ट्रक्शंस पे करते हैं और पहले भी ये इन्होंने टारगेट किया है जो पंचायत के मेंबर रहे हैं
मीनवाइल पुलिस कॉर्डन्ड ऑफ द होल एरिया एंड लॉन्च्ड अ सर्च ऑपरेशन टू नैप द अटैकर्स द बैक टू बैक अटैक्स इन जम्मू एंड कश्मीर कम एट अ टाइम when campaigning was underway for the parliamentary polls for Anantnag Rajouri seat. These attacks are not isolated incidents but bear significance amidst the electoral process. Such assaults on civilians and key figures like Sheikh reflect a desperate attempt by Pakistan to instill fear among the populace. This desperation is further compounded by recent claims of absolute normalcy in the valley post the abrogation of Article 370, as stated by India's PM Narendra Modi and Interior Minister Amit Shah. As Jammu and Kashmir experiences socio-economic growth in recent years, Pakistan seeks to radicalize local elements to disrupt this progress.
इस तरह की किलिंग करके किस तरह से डर का माहौल पैदा किया जाए ताकि इलेक्शन में कम वोटिंग हो परसेंटेज गिरे, लोगों में दहशत का माहौल हो, ये उसी को नजरी मद्देनजर रखते हुए किया जा रहा है। ये चाहते हैं किसी तरह इस तरह के इंसिडेंट करके इसको परसेंटेज को दोबारा गिराया जाए, ताकि दुनिया में दिखाया जाए कि यहाँ तो डेमोक्रेसी नाम की कोई चीज नहीं।
There has been a spike in targeted killings, particularly against civilians, political workers and minority communities such as Kashmiri Pandits and non-local laborers. Beyond the immediate security concerns, the twin terror attacks underscore deeper challenges facing Jammu and Kashmir. Since the abrogation of Article 370 and Article 35A, security forces have intensified efforts to combat unlawful activities aimed at disrupting peace and unity in the Union Territory. However, amidst rapid development and infrastructure projects, the region faces resistance from external forces aiming to destabilize it. Moving forward, Indian security forces remain vigilant in safeguarding the region's progress against such threats.
Frustration is mounting in Pakistan's largest city, Karachi, as residents grapple with persistent power cuts and gas shortages. Karachi is sweltering under the summer sun and tempers are flaring along with the temperatures. For weeks, residents have been facing extended periods of load shedding, meaning intentional blackouts to manage the energy grid. This, coupled with gas shortages, is making daily life a struggle for many.
Karachi, the bustling economic hub of Pakistan, is currently grappling with severe electricity and gas shortages. Prolonged load shedding has left many residents without power and gas for hours each day, especially amid the hot weather, exacerbating the difficulties faced by households and businesses alike. The city has been without electricity for 3 consecutive days. This week, women and children in a locality disrupted traffic to raise the issue, but lamented the police did not let them to even protest. They said authorities are ignoring their pleas and this is injustice being meted on them.
तीन दिन से धरना भी दे रहे हैं, सब कुछ कर रहे हैं, कोई सुनवाई नहीं है। इस मुल्क का क्या बनेगा? लाइट नहीं, गैस नहीं, पानी नहीं, अवाम कहाँ जाए? वैसे तो हमारे पाकिस्तान में बिक गया सब, सब अवाम बिक गई, सब। लेकिन खुदा रहा, छोटे छोटे बच्चे, जिनके बच्चे पढ़ रहे हैं, वो क्या साल भर फीसें भर रहे हैं, ये सब गरीब अवाम है, मेहनत मजदूरी कर रहे हैं, क्या हो रहा है इनके साथ?
The power supply interruptions have extended beyond 12 hours in various neighborhoods, significantly impacting daily life. The city's sole power supplier, K Electric, has attributed this prolonged load shedding to low gas pressure, which affects its electricity generation capability. K Electric currently generates 500 megawatts of electricity using RLNG, regasified liquefied natural gas. If the gas supply stops, the company could face difficulties in maintaining this level of generation, potentially leading up to 17 hours of load shedding. Despite the growing outcry, the Pakistani government has yet to provide a concrete plan to alleviate the shortages. The load shedding has not only disrupted the daily lives of the residents but also posed a serious threat to their health and well-being.
यहां लाइट नहीं है, यहां बच्चे जो है बीमार बच्चे जो है वो मरीज मर रहे हैं, बीमार हो रहे हैं, गर्मी बहुत ज्यादा है, पानी नहीं है, गैस नहीं है। अरे भाई, जब वोट चाहिए थे तो सब आ गए, आज जब यहां मुश्किल वक्त में यहां के लोग खड़े हैं, कोई खड़ा होने को तैयार नहीं है।
The residents' plight is further exacerbated by the fact that despite the frequent load shedding, they are forced to pay hefty bills. This has led to widespread discontent among the locals, who are demanding immediate action from the authorities. As Karachi continues to endure the hardships of electricity and gas load shedding, the patience of its residents is wearing thin. The city's populace awaits effective measures from the Pakistani government and utility providers to restore normalcy and ensure a stable supply of essential services.
India's battle against terrorism takes a significant leap forward as the anti-terrorism squad makes a groundbreaking arrest. Four Sri Lankan nationals suspected to be linked with the Islamic State were apprehended in Ahmedabad. With loaded pistols and an ISIS flag recovered, the arrest underscores the global reach of terrorist networks. These individuals, in touch with an ISIS leader in Pakistan, had visited India dozens of times, raising concerns about radicalization. Despite ISIS efforts to expand its presence in India, proactive measures by security agencies have consistently thwarted terror plots. This arrest not only disrupts potential threats, but also reaffirms India's unwavering commitment to combating terrorism and safeguarding its citizens.
India's anti-terrorism squad has made a significant breakthrough in its counter-terrorism efforts. On May 20th, India's anti-terror police apprehended four Sri Lankan nationals in the western Indian city of Ahmedabad for suspected links to the Islamic State terror outfit. The arrested individuals were identified as Muhammad Nusrat, Muhammad Nafran, Muhammad Faris and Muhammad Rashdeen, all residents of Colombo, Sri Lanka. The ATS also recovered three loaded pistols and an Islamic State flag from a location near Ahmedabad, identified from photos in the suspects' mobile phones.
ये हमें 18 तारीख को एक इन्फॉर्मेशन मिली थी कि ये जो चार नाम है ये लोग श्रीलंका से अहमदाबाद आने वाले हैं या इधर ट्रेन या फ्लाइट के रूट से आएंगे एंड ये यहाँ पे किसी टेरर एक्टिविटी को अंजाम देने वाले हैं. ये मूलतः इस्लामिक स्टेट जो एक बैंड टेररिस्ट ऑर्गेनाइजेशन है इससे जुड़े हुए हैं. तो इस इन्फॉर्मेशन पे हमने वर्कआउट किया. हमने श्रीलंका से आती हुई डायरेक्ट फ्लाइट्स, इनडायरेक्ट फ्लाइट्स, इसके साथ में साउथ की तरफ से आती हुई बहुत सारी ट्रेन्स और जितने भी रूट्स हैं उन सबको चेक किया, उनके मैनिफेस्ट चेक किए गए. तो जो हमारी इन्फॉर्मेशन है उस इन्फॉर्मेशन के नाम वाले चारों लोग का हमें एक फ्लाइट के अंदर उनका बुकिंग डिटेल्स मिल गया और वो चारों जो टिकट्स है वो एक ही PNR पे बुक हुई थी. तो हमें लगा कि ये वही लोग हो सकते हैं. इसके बाद में उसको बैक ट्रैक किया गया तो वो सेम नाम के लोग उसी दिन सुबह यानी कि कल 19 तारीख को मॉर्निंग में कोलंबो से चेन्नई की फ़्लाइट में आ रहे. चेन्नई में लगभग 3 घंटे के लेओवर के बाद में वो लोग अहमदाबाद लैंड होने वाले थे. तो हमने सारी प्रोसेस की टीम्स बनाई, अहमदाबाद एयरपोर्ट से उनको डिटेन किया.
Police have registered a case under sections of the Unlawful Activities Act, the Indian Penal Code and the Arms Act against the four suspects. Vikas Sahai, the top police officer in Gujarat state, stated that the arrests were made late on May 19 at the city's airport following a tip-off. Sahai mentioned that the Gujarat police's anti-terrorism squad found an Islamic State flag in their possession. Analysis of two seized mobile phones showed various photographs and videos indicating that they were involved with the terrorist group. Since February 2024, these four individuals had been in touch with a person named Abu, who resides in Pakistan and is an ISIS leader. They were communicating with him online through various social media platforms.
कि आज चार लोगों फरवरी 2024 में एक व्यक्ति नामे अबू जे मूल श्रीलंका ना छे पण अत्यारे पाकिस्तान मा रहे छे अने आईसिस ना लीडर छे एमनी साथे संपर्क मा आव्या फेब्रुअरी 2024 मा अने त्यार थी लेने अत्यार सुधी एमनी साथे ऑनलाइन संपर्क मा रह्या अलग अलग सोशल मीडिया मार्फते.
द गुजरात एंटी टेररिज्म स्क्वाड रिवील्ड that two of the four Sri Lankans, Nusrat and Nafran, arrested on May 20, had visited India 38 to 40 times. These individuals are highly radicalized and have shown their radical mindsets earlier through other organizations.
इन लोगों की इंडिया में इन्होंने टोटल कितनी विजिट की है इसके बारे में भी थोड़ी इन्वेस्टिगेशन की गई थी. तो इसमें जो फारिस और रसदीन है ये पहली बार इंडिया आए हैं
लेकिन नुसरत और नफरान जो है वो लगभग 38 और 40 बार इससे पहले इंडिया में आए हैं। तो एज ऑफ नाउ ये हाईली रेडिकल है और रेडिकल जो इनका माइंडसेट है उसको जब शो इन्होंने पहले भी दूसरे ऑर्गेनाइजेशन के माध्यम से किया, आईएस के हैंडलर में आने के बाद में आईएस के प्रोपोगंडा वीडियो से प्रभावित होकर के आईएस के हैंडलर ने और इन्होंने जो सोशल मीडिया पर बहुत सारी चीजें देखी उससे ये रेडिकलाइज होकर के इस मॉड्यूल के साथ जुड़े हैं।
The apprehension of these individuals is expected to disrupt potential terror plots and improve public safety. It also highlights the growing reach of international terrorist networks. This incident comes on the heels of recent arrests of ISIS operatives in India, including two leaders apprehended near the international border after crossing over from Bangladesh. These individuals were involved in recruitment, terror funding and planning terror acts using improvised explosive devices, according to security officials. The National Investigation Agency and ATS units in various states have been actively pursuing cases related to ISIS activities in India, highlighting the persistent threat posed by the terrorist organization. In October last year, a suspected ISIS terrorist wanted in connection with the Pune ISIS module case was apprehended by the Delhi police. Though ISIS is attempting to expand its footprint in India, security agencies have successfully foiled multiple ISIS-linked terror plots in recent years, demonstrating their proactive approach.
It's an encouraging sign when it comes to our preparedness that we were able to figure out that although there were Sri Lankans coming from Sri Lanka with whom India does not have enmity, that they were up to no good. So at least our intelligence gathering has evolved to that level that even if a threat emanates to India from outside Pakistan, even in friendly countries, so to speak, our security agencies are up to the task of apprehending them before they could actually do some real damage.
Through rigorous surveillance, intelligence gathering and preemptive operations, Indian authorities have thwarted the nefarious plans of ISIS operatives and their associates. These efforts underscore India's commitment to countering terrorism and ensuring the safety and security of its citizens.
It's been nearly 3 years since the Taliban took over Kabul on August 15, 2021. The event changed the South Asian nation in many ways, with the most profound impact being experienced by the Afghan women. From Kabul to Kandahar, Afghanistan's women navigate a landscape of shattered dreams under Taliban rule. Firuzzan Kohistani, once an NGO worker, now battles economic turmoil as she strives to keep her cake factory running. In a nation gripped by crisis, her story illuminates the resilience and determination of Afghan women in the face of adversity.
Imagine a world where dreams are shattered and the sky falls apart into countless fragments. This became the stark reality for Afghanistan when the Taliban regime seized control. The impact on women was especially devastating. Over the past 2.5 years since the Taliban regained power, Afghanistan has seen the world's most severe women's rights crisis unfold. This regime has methodically stripped women and girls of their fundamental rights, affecting their education, employment, freedom of speech and movement, and political participation, among many other freedoms. This is veteran NGO worker Firuzzan Kohistani, who lost her job and had to search for a new career when the Taliban seized control of Afghanistan in 2021. Determined to make a difference, she founded her own cake factory, aiming to provide a lifeline for Afghan women unable to work under the new regime's restrictions. Kohistani took a loan of $4,870 to start her business. By 2022, she had built up the factory's production and hired 15 women and 5 men.
قبلاً در حکومت جمهوریت ما در یکی از دفاتر وظیفه داشتم زمانی که وظیفه خود دست دادم تصمیم گرفتم که چی کار کنم بیکار مانده نمیتونستم بتانم خدمت هم بر خود و هم بر جامعه خدمت گذار باشم در هر حالت در هر شرایطی تصمیم گرفتم که می بزنس شروع کنم تا از همه طریق مظهر خدمت شوم بر خواهرای عزیزم که فعلا در خانه بیکار هستن از دست ماندین بعضشان و بعضشان نانآور فامیل هستن.
Initially, Furuzan Kohistani generated around $1,390 per month, covering her employees' salaries and her family's needs. However, as Afghanistan's economy deteriorated, her monthly income halved within a year, pushing her business towards bankruptcy. 2 months ago, Kohistani applied for another loan but was rejected because she is still repaying her initial loan. Desperate to save her business, she is now seeking financial help from friends.
وقتی به بانک مراجعه میکنیم که ما قرضه بگیریم بانک بر ما میگه قوالی شرعی داشته باشی قوالی خانه را بیاری یکی یک مشکل عمده ما خانم ها اینمی است و مشکل عمده ما دیگه ای است که وقتی که ما میگه که شما 2 نفر از کارمندوی بر حال امارت را بیاری که ضمانتتان کنه ما 2 نفر ضمانت نمیتونیم پیدا کنیم.
With the future uncertain, many of Kohistani's employees fear that the factory's closure would leave them with no choice but to beg on the streets. A United Nations Development Programme study released in mid-April highlighted the struggles of female-led businesses like Kohistani's. The report found that 41% of 3,100 Afghan female entrepreneurs surveyed had to take on debt, but only 5% secured credit through a bank or microfinance institution, relying instead on loans from family or friends.
Low demand for their goods, a restricted ability to export due to these payment blockages, inability to access inputs again for their businesses, real challenges accessing finance, and that's something we talk about in the report which we published. Only 5% of these women entrepreneurs are able to get loans from banks, and there are major restrictions on their movement and their ability to do business because of discrimination and so on.
The UNDP study also revealed that over 70% of Afghan female entrepreneurs cannot travel to local markets without a male guardian. Although the Taliban have not formally banned women from working, they have imposed severe restrictions, including barring many female aid workers, closing beauty salons, and limiting women's movement and employment opportunities. Despite these challenges, some female entrepreneurship continues.
And with that, we come to the end of this edition of Newsweek South Asia. We'll be back next week with more news, views and analysis from the subcontinent. Meanwhile, do keep writing to us at nwsa@anin.com. This is Shivangi Mishra signing off on behalf of the entire production team of Newsweek South Asia. Goodbye and take care.